It's this great honor to be here, to be a lecturer on this occasion. I met Walter Rosenblith in 82 when he was made foreign secretary of the Academy. I had been elected a few years earlier, and I was quite active in a variety of programs, so we kept meeting on and off over time, including the years when I was in the Governing Council of the Academy. I have, as I said, we never became particularly close, but all my interactions with him and my memories are very positive, and I'm therefore honored, greatly honored, to have been selected as the lecturer today. And I'm very honored to have here Mrs. Rosenblith and other members of the family. Thank you. And thank you also the president of the Academy, Ralph Cicerone, for having organized this event. And again, Mike, for the introduction. I should thank also whoever prepared this cover for the slides. Mine was much less interesting. This is the one I sent. So I have a guess as to who may have done it, but anyway, thank you for whoever did that. There is a narrative in the history of the ideas that says there were two great scientific revolutions, the Copernican Revolution and the Darwinian Revolution. The Copernican Revolution started in 1543, this is overly active, it seems, in 1543, the year of his death, when he published this book on the revolutions of the celestial bodies in Latin, as all the scientific books were published at the time. And the narrative points out that what Copernicus did was to change the position of the Earth, which was being perceived at the time as the center of the known universe, and made of the Earth just one more planet around the sun. Here we have Terra, the Latin word for Earth, and the moon. And then we have Mercury, Venus, then the sun, Solis, Mars, Jupiter, Saturn, and then the constellations of the stars. It was all what was known at the time. This is from a contemporary German textbook. And here is the drawing made by Copernicus, by his own hand. Now he has the sun in the middle, Sol, Mercury, Venus, the Earth with the moon, Mars, Jupiter, Saturn, and then the constellations of the stars. Similarly, the narrative says there was a Darwinian revolution which consisted in moving humans, our species, from being the center of the living world into becoming just one more species among the thousands and thousands and thousands that are known to exist. And this is attributed to, particularly to his book on the origin of species, published in 1859, and where the idea, this is a contemporary drawing, but the idea is that now we know that humans share ancestors with other organisms, and now we know specifically the chimpanzees, our closest relatives. Well, this narrative of the history of ideas is very deficient, not for what it says, which is correct, but because of it doesn't say, which is what is most important. What is most important about these two revolutions is that they are the two parts, the two stages, if you wish, of the scientific revolution. Science, in the modern sense, starts indeed with Copernicus, but one has to see the contribution of Copernicus in the context of his successors, Galileo and Newton, just about 100 years apart from each other. And the discovery was, starting with Copernicus himself, that the assertion that the Earth, the world, consists of matter in motion governed by natural laws, but that these natural laws can be discovered, simple laws which are universal, which apply to entities, to bodies on Earth as well as in the heavens, and that they can be subject to observation and experiment, and thereby being corroborated or falsified. So here we have Galileo, Newton, and laws like these simple ones, force equal mass times acceleration, or the inverse law of attraction between bodies. The attraction between two bodies is proportional to their product, but inversely related to the square of their distance. Well, the Copernican revolution, with all the enormous accomplishments that took place in getting science in the modern sense started and developed to a large extent, had left out organisms, and had left them out for a very good reason, which was articulated better than by anybody else by William Paley in this book, published actually in 1802. This is not the original edition. William Paley was an Anglican minister and an author of books of theology, but was particularly popular as an abolitionist. He was speaking all over the place in the United Kingdom. In 1800, he became ill, and he decided to dedicate the rest of his life to study biology, which had advanced enormously in the last few decades of the 18th century. And the knowledge of biology, as was known at the time, is summarized in this book. But the point of the book is that organisms, the living world, are clearly designed, and where is design, there is a designer. The argument that the design of the world, and particularly the design of organisms, was a proof of the existence of the creator, of God, had been made all through the Judeo-Christian tradition, in fact, even earlier than that, by some of the great authors of classic Greece, great philosophers. But nobody had articulated the argument in so much detail and so, with so much knowledge of the biology as William Paley. In that book, it's about 350 pages, it's beautifully written, and he again and again points out to features of organisms, for example, the relationships between the sexes, the relationship between predators and prey, between plants and animals, and again, he shows in each case that there is evidence of precise design, precise relationships, precise arrangements of parts, and repeats again and again, wherever there is design, there is a designer. So this proof or an argument for the existence of God. He starts the book by saying, assume that I am walking with a friend in a park, and suddenly, accidentally, I kick a stone. And my friend asks me, where does that stone come from? And Paley says rhetorically, well, I don't have anything to explain. For all what I know, that rock could have been there forever. But assume that we walk a little farther, and suddenly I see a watch on the ground. And my friend asks me the same question, where does the watch come from? He says, clearly, I cannot give the same answer. The watch is made of very precisely integrated parts that all have to be functioning together for the watch to tell time. So there is a watch, there is a watchmaker. And then starts the argument about the design of organisms using first the human eye. Here you have a human eye. I have highlighted a few parts, you know, the cornea, the lens, the retina, then the optic nerve, the various vessels and the like. He points out something very interesting and compares it with the best optical instruments that existed at the time, microscopes and telescopes, and points out that the eye is probably more precise than the best telescope ever built. We are talking about 1802, at the beginning of the 19th century, such that rays of light that start from a single point and diverge when they enter the lens, they will converge, and they converge exactly at the place where the retina is. He also points out the only dark body, the only dark tissue that exists in the body, again, so that it can register the coming of the light rays. What greater evidence would we need? What more evidence could we have to provide to know that this has been designed by an omnipotent creator, by God. Well, that was accepted all through the time, through the history of Christianity, certainly, and up to the middle of the 19th century, when Darwin, in 1859, published his book On the Origin of Species, which is a book dedicated to explain how natural processes can account for the design of organisms. Darwin had graduated from the University of Cambridge in 1831, and then went in a trip around the world for 5 years. And just at the end of that trip, he discovers natural selection while he's still a young man in his late 20s. And he decides to dedicate his life to study natural selection and to demonstrate in what way natural selection can explain the diversity of organisms, what we call now evolution, a word that he does not use in that book, the diversity of organisms, their changes through time, but particularly their design. Darwin knows that the significance of his discovery is not the explanation of evolution. Evolution was accepted by most biologists by the middle of the 19th century. What was important of his discovery was explaining design and therefore completing the Copernican revolution. Because now everything in the physical universe, the universe that we experience with our senses, could be explained by scientific hypotheses. Not only inorganic matter, not only the Earth and the stars and the continents, but also organisms, including humans, and their design. You have heard, surely, that The Origin of a Species is a book about evolution. Well, it is not. It is a book about natural selection. Darwin, at the time, was working on a multi-volume work, which was going to be called Natural Selection. He, for historical reasons, he hurried in to prepare what he considered a summary of his multi-volume work, and is why he don't call this book Natural Selection, but he still highlights as the origin of a species by means of natural selection. The first 8 chapters of the book are dedicated to natural selection, and then at the beginning of chapter 9, he says, as it were, well, if the theory that I have been developing is correct to explain the sign, then evolution must have occurred, and must have occurred in a certain way. So he brings evolution as evidence for natural selection and points out that evolution, if his theory is correct, would not occur the way it was generally accepted by the biologists of the time, who thought more or less was a gradual process, going, everything changing at a time in any given organism. He said, no, if my theory is correct, organisms may have some parts changing at some time or in some place, and other parts at other times or in other places, and some organisms may not change because if the environment does not change, there is no need for natural selection to promote change. And then he has 2 chapters dedicated to what we would call now paleontology. He calls it geology. That is, of course, geology involved there. Then 2 chapters dedicated to biogeography, that is the distribution of organisms throughout the world, particularly islands. Then 1 chapter to what now we would call comparative anatomy and embryology. And then in the final chapter, goes back to natural selection. So first 8 chapters and the last one, 14th, are natural selection. There are 5 chapters on evolution, but evolution to account for natural selection. Oops. In chapter 4, at the very beginning, he summarized the concept of natural selection in a few words, which I am quoting here. Now, he says, can it be thought improbable that variations useful in some way to each being in the great and complex battle of life should sometimes occur in the course of thousands of generations. Well, those omission points there refer to part of his argument in chapter one, where he refers to artificial selection. The selection as is practiced by farmers and by animal breeders. And what he had done in the first chapter is to point out that variations which are hereditary, which we can use for our own benefit, occur in organisms. So he's going to argue now, if variations useful to us occur in organisms, should it be improbable that variations would occur that are beneficial to the organisms themselves? Well, if such do occur, can we doubt that individuals having any advantage, however slight, over others would have the best chance of surviving and of procreating their kind? On the other hand, we may feel sure that any variation in the least degree injurious would be rigidly destroyed. This preservation of favorable variations and the rejection of injurious variations I call natural selection. I should point out, by the way, that he didn't write that with a Spanish accent. I add the Spanish accent for color. Okay. So anyway, it's a very simple concept. Now, of course, we have an enormous mathematical theory and an enormous amount of evidence around the theory of natural selection, but he gathered, explained the concept, explained the evidence, and then particularly used the evidence from evolution to demonstrate natural selection. A simple example of how natural selection works from the middle of the 20th century. This is a moth, which is known commonly as the peppered moth. It's very common in the west forest, in the wet forest of central England, and it is called the peppered moth. The technical name is Biston betularia, because as you can see, or maybe you cannot see, it has a peppered configuration that is like salt and pepper. The moth is actually here. There's the peppered moth. Now, mutations occur in the peppered moth, which make just one single gene, makes them dark. There are lots of collections of these moths in Britain, dating from the beginning of the 19th century and earlier. Around 1850, the first moth appears in a collection which is dark. And then they start to increase in frequency, more and more in the collections that are not intended to record any particular numbers, but just you see that there are more moths. What was happening is the Industrial Revolution. The use of coal as a source of energy produces soot, which kills the lichens that covers the bark of the trees in the wet forest and gives them this color. And now the moth becomes cryptic, which is difficult to see, is the dark moth. The regular type, the wild type as we call it, is now very visible. The main predators of these moths are birds, and birds see very much the way we see. So on the trees covered by lichens, whenever a moth appeared, which was dark, that was the first one to be eaten. However, now the ones which are eaten after the Industrial Revolution had come about are the wild type. Around 1965, the British government passed rather strict laws controlling pollution and the use of coal, so that the frequency of dark moths that had increased in the collections, and by that time in the studies done by evolutionists, that was increasing greatly, reaching 60% and 70% in some places, then it starts to decrease, and then gradually has been, again, nearly eliminated, the dark moth, because now don't have the advantage that they have. Well, one of the great places to study evolution is evolution by natural selection are the archipelagos, which are very isolated, relatively large masses of land, which are very isolated for any continent. Why? Because these archipelagos have been rarely colonize, because living organisms, most organisms evolve in continents, have a hard time, a very improbable way of making it to the archipelago. This is Hawaii, a little more than 2,000 miles away from where I live in Irvine, in Southern California, and the most isolated important mass of land in the world. Now, there are a number of islands, as you all know. In fact, the islands of the archipelago go beyond Kauai all the way to Midway Island. Midway Island was formed, like all these islands, right here, where the Kilauea volcano is active right now. There is a hole on the earth, as it were, through which lava comes intermittently. So when the eruption is happening continuously for some time, the mass accumulates and eventually crosses the surface of the ocean, and you have an island. The other process that is going on is that these islands are on the North Atlantic, Northwest Atlantic, I'm sorry, Northwest plate, continental plate. In this Pacific plate is moving westerly, northwesterly, at a rate of about 2 inches per year. So the islands are formed here, and as they're being formed, they're moving away. When there are no volcanic eruptions for some time, then when the volcanic eruptions start again, then it's a new island. And in the meantime, the islands are moving away, farther away from Kauai, like Midway Island, very famous of Midway Atoll in Second World War. There's now nothing left of the island, really, an atoll. This island of Kauai was formed there about 4 million years ago. The Kohala Mountains, as they are called, the volcano in this at this tip of the big island, was a little less than 1 million years ago, and Kilauea is active right now. So here you have the big island of Hawaii, and with Mauna Kea and Mauna Loa formed a few hundred thousand years ago. And here you have the Kilauea volcano, the Kilauea crater, still active. Well, what happens when one looks at islands, and this was Darwin's argument, made about the Galapagos Islands, which we will see in a moment, is that because they are rarely colonized, the animals or plants that colonize these archipelagos find no competitors there. So they prosper, they diversify, they form many species closely related. So what you find, as Darwin would argue, is that there are very few kinds of organisms, but those that exist there are very, very highly diversified. And let me start with an example. As an example, Drosophila flies. These are the flies that we geneticists use in the laboratories to do genetic experiments. There are 2,000 species in the world. 500 of them are in Hawaii. The area of Hawaii is certainly smaller than the state of Maryland, and yet you have 25% of all the species of Drosophila in the world. Then the same with other organisms. Insects, 3,750 species. That number may not seem to you very small, but it's actually very small. There are 750,000 species of insects known. This is less than half of 1%. And notice that of that half of 1% of these 3,000 plus species, they are of very few kinds. In fact, 15% of all the insects are Drosophila. There are lots of snails, but then there are no land mammals, there are no reptiles, there are not amphibians, and many other kinds of organisms are missing. So again, the idea that Darwin develops in the first two chapters, where he provides evidence for evolution, and the evolution happens according to natural selection, the idea is that there have been very few colonizers, in the case of insects, probably carried by air currents or sometimes in flotsam. But once they reach there, they have tremendous opportunity to diversify. And he was not fortunate enough to visit Hawaii. I think he would have been fascinated. But he spent quite a bit of time in the Galapagos Islands. The Galapagos Islands are about 500 miles west of, on the equator, west of the country called Ecuador, which is also on the equator. And he spent quite some time there and studied these creatures called Galapagos. This is the Spanish word for tortoise, for these large turtles. These are huge animals, weigh several hundred pounds. They move very slowly looking for water and feeding on vegetation. A very different style of the life that most turtles do elsewhere, almost certainly colonized by marine turtles. But then in each island, they have given rise to different species, because one of these turtles, a fertile female, has to be, has the opportunity to multiply there and to evolve. It evolves in isolation from any other turtles, so it evolves its own way. So here you have very different configurations. These animals could survive in the Galapagos only because they were not predators. If there would be predators, they don't have a chance. Darwin measured the rate at which they move by sitting on one of them and measuring the distance and the time. He estimated that they walk at less than 1 mile per hour. So imagine how susceptible they would be to any predators. Famously also, he studied the so-called finches. There is only one species related to these birds in the Western South American continent, in Peru, Ecuador, Bolivia, in that area. And yet, in the Galapagos Islands, in the relatively small amount of land, you have about a dozen of them, going from very small to some fairly large, and they have become adapted to feeding in ways completely different from those in the mainland. Some feed on seeds, some on fruits and buds, some on insects. So again, this opportunity to diversify there, because they don't find other competitors, and taking advantage of the circumstances that arise, and also the isolation from island to island, which gives rise to different species evolving in different islands. This is a summary of when these islands of the Galapagos were formed, starting about 4.5 million years ago, and where the species of the finches were formed as we know them today. Well, the other kind of argumentation that Darwin was using, another kind, was geology and paleontology. In the first, the second, third, really, of the 19th century, geology have come of age. Several important books, major books, were published around 1830 or thereabouts. And what the geologists have discovered is that the strata that are found on the Earth when the Earth gets exposed are actually sediments that form at the bottom of the ocean. And therefore, the strata that are higher up have formed more recently than the ones that are farther down. That means that when fossils are found, as it is the case here, this is the Great Canyon, the Grand Canyon of the Colorado River, about 1 mile from top to the river, about 2 billion years of sediments. When fossils are found, those who are at the bottom lived much earlier than those that are higher up. And of course, the evidence from paleontology was enormous, and Darwin discusses that in some detail. Here I have a modern reconstruction of the evolution of the horse, here starting with a very tiny horse called Hyracotherion, about the size of a medium-sized dog, that lived about 55 million years ago, to the modern horse, which is much larger, has only one toe rather than four, and many other differences. And these branches represent different species. This is the one way that we use to represent the origin of a species. When a new species arises, it's a new branch. When it becomes extinct, the branch ends. Notice that most species here of horses, like it is true of all kinds of organisms, most species that have ever existed have become extinct. Very few of them survive. Well, when the origin of species was published, critics of the Darwin's theory said, if evolution is a gradual process, evolution by natural selection is a gradual process, where are the intermediates between large groups of organisms, for example, between reptiles and birds? And here you have a creature called Archaeopteryx, which was discovered 2 years, the first fossil of Archaeopteryx was discovered 2 years after the publication of The Origin of Species in what is today Bavaria, is as intermediate between a bird and a reptile as you could be. The skeleton is larger in that of a reptile, actually a dinosaur with a very big tail. The beak, the head, the beak, and the feathers are clearly features that we associate with birds. Darwin, in later editions of The Origin of Species, refers to this intermediate. A very interesting discovery very recently is this creature Tiktaalik, intermediate between fishes and amphibians. Up to about 7 or 8 years ago, these two species were known, that when you look at them, and the experts look at them, they know that they're amphibians. Although you see they have somewhat the configuration of a fish in certain respects. Here you have these other ones, which are clearly fish, although they start to show some features, particularly in the shape of the cranium and others, similar to amphibians. So this Acanthostega lived about 375 million years ago, Panderectis about 385 million years ago. A group of paleontologists from the University of Chicago then identified a territory in northern Canada in the Innu territory that knew there were deposits dated 380 million years ago. So they went there, and after 3 years of searching, during the few months where they could be there searching because of the Arctic weather not very favorable, eventually they discovered this creature Tiktaalik, which lived about 380 million years ago as intermediate between a fish and a reptile as it could be. This, by the way, earned election to the National Academy of Sciences to the person who was leading that research, Neil Shubin from the University of Chicago. Clearly, the intermediates that were most bothersome and source of objection by the critics are the intermediates between apes and humans. We are related to primates. Where are the intermediates? Well, Darwin died without any intermediate between chimps and humans, or between apes and humans, would be known. But in recent times, as we will see in a moment, many, many species have discovered of what are called hominids, or hominins, that is, species that are ancestral to us after the separation from the lineage that goes to the chimpanzees. So now this is a very active field of research, and there are hundreds of species known, some of them represented here and some are not. Here you have the age, 7 million years is about when the lineage going to the chimpanzees and to us branch off. And then here you have species of hominids and hominins. So they have exotic names. Only at about 2 million years ago, they start to be called humans, Homo. Before they have different names. They have here Homo habilis, then other species of Homo. And eventually, here we are, appear only 150,000 years ago. All these species and more. And these bars represent the time when these, the length of time when these species were alive. If we look at the main differences between the apes and us, the ones which are very conspicuous to non-experts, then there are two clear ones. One is the bipedal posture. We walk on two legs. Apes walk on their four, as you will see in a moment. Chimps and gorillas, they rest in the forearm, they have very long forearms, and in the knuckles, it's called knuckle walking. Well, so one is the bipedal posture, which requires many changes in the skeleton, human skeleton, and the other one is the large brain. Our brain is 3 to 4 times larger than that of a gorilla or a chimpanzee. And here you have a fossil about 3.5 million years ago, a fossil that was discovered by a group of paleontologists from University of California at Berkeley, that they baptized Lucy. The scientific name is Australopithecus afarensis. This is the first time that so many bones of a single individual were found together. These paleontologists, both of whom are still active, and they are great manipulators of the media, and they describe Lucy as having happened when they were listening to the Beatles, Lucy in the Sky with Diamonds, and anyway, many other elements in the publication of this fossil came about, made Lucy very famous. As a consequence, the United States government and many foundations started to invest more money in looking for human fossils, and that's why we have now thousands of them and dozens of species. But so Lucy was clearly bipedal, as I'm going to persuade you of it, I hope, by looking just at the hip bone. A paleontologist looks at many other parts of those bones and knows the sea was bipedal. But for us who are not expert, the way is to reconstruct the hip here, the hip bone, and the hip of a modern human. I have enlarged it in size because Lucy was less than 3 feet tall as an adult, was an adult young woman. But I have enlarged it so that we can compare the configuration and then with that of a gorilla or a chimpanzee. And it's clear that with the hip bone, she could not walk the way gorillas and chimps walk. So she had to walk bipedal. So we know that bipedalism came very early in human evolution, almost right away after our divergence from the branch that goes to the chimps. But the brain started to increase only much later. And I'm not going to go into the details of that, but briefly, the brain starts to increase only with Homo habilis. Still has about a brain slightly less than a pound, like in a chimpanzee. But Homo habilis is called habilis, able, or tool maker, precisely because he started to make tools. And as a consequence of the tool making, the brain started to enlarge, because to make tools, you need to be smart to anticipate what use you are going to make of the tool. So that brain ancestors of us who were more intelligent made better tools, survived better, reproduced more, and the brain kept enlarging so that in 2 million years, enlarged by more than a factor of 3, which is a very, very fast rate of evolution. Well, the final kind of evidence that Darwin considered was comparative anatomy of embryology. And the argument is as follows, using this particular example. Here we have a dog, the forelimb of a dog, a human, a whale, and a bird. They are all made up of the same components organized in the same way. They have been slightly modified, as Darwin was arguing, to serve different functions, because each one of these animals uses the forelimbs in different ways. We use the forelimb to write or to point out, and a dog uses it for running, and a whale for swimming, and a bird for flying. So why would we be made of the same bones organized of the same way? Well, because of tictalic. Of course, Darwin didn't know about tictalic, that intermediate between the fishes and the amphibians. We started to develop these basic structures, which now all the land vertebrates have, including ourselves. Something happened in the 20th century, in the middle of the 20th century, namely molecular biology came about. The discovery of DNA, the structure of DNA, and this new field, exploding field ever since, something about which Darwin knew nothing. And of course, this field of molecular biology has provided the strongest and most detailed evidence, not only of evolution in general, but how species are related with each other, that is, living species. As of now, we are not very good at studying DNA of fossils, but we live in a species we can reconstruct now, and has been reconstructed completely, the evolutionary history of all the several million species that live now on Earth. And I'm going to point out here the first example, cytochrome C, the first major example showing this evidence for various reasons. One is because it was published in 1967, when this field was just starting, but provided, as you will see in a moment, a very convincing evidence of evolution and reconstructing evolutionary history. There was a paper published in the journal called Science by two authors, Walter Fitch, one of them, and Emmanuel Margolyes. Emmanuel Margolyes was a protein chemist, died some years ago. Walter Fitch was our colleague at Irvine for many years. He passed away about a year ago, a little more than a year ago. So they studied this molecule because it was very small. At that time, 1960s, there was no way to study DNA, to sequence it, get the letters in the DNA by any method. Now is the way we do it. It's much easier to get the sequences of the DNA letters than of the protein letters. DNA, the genes code for proteins. Proteins could be studied at the time, and it was very laborious. Cytochrome C is a very small molecule, so Fitch and Margolyes look at 20 species and obtain the sequence of the amino acids, starting here with glycine, and they go in that way, and continue on top for the human sequence, and ending here with glutamic acid. I'm using these three-letter abbreviations. Then here you have the sequence of rhesus monkeys, and it's identical to the human sequence, except for one component, one letter, isoleucine in humans, threonine in monkeys. Interestingly enough, the horse has also threonine, and so do many other animals. So we know that this difference was not due to a change in the monkey, was due to a change in humans, because all the other species have threonine. This will be relevant immediately. And then when you compare those two with the horse, then there are 11 or 12 differences. Since evolution is a gradual process, here we have human and monkeys, one difference, 12 with horse, monkey and horse, 11. That means that humans and monkeys have ancestors much more recently than they have with a horse. And that is, in this very simplified example, here you have it. But we know, importantly, that the one difference between monkeys and humans happened in the human lineage, not in the monkey lineage. And so they studied 20 species, and they got a table like that, not with three numbers like the one that I was showing you before, but with this enormous number of differences between these 20 species. And then they fed this information at the computer. There is no way by hand to find the best solution of the evolutionary tree for these 20 species based on these numbers. But computers, which were becoming available to scientists about that time in the mid-1960s, so they fed this to a computer, and this is what the computer gave them. You see here you have an ancestor, which we know now live about 2 billion years ago, and then one branch goes to the yeasts and the fungi, another branch goes to the animals, there's another branch in there, one going to the insects, the other to the vertebrates, and so on for the various vertebrates, including humans. This is from a recent figure from the Encyclopedia Britannica. In fact, it's my figure. I have written for the last 25 years or so the long article on evolution for the Encyclopedia Britannica. But anyway, they presented this drawing, not in color. But this is amazing, that with one little molecule, you could reconstruct the evolution of 2 billion years and 20 species as different as they are. When that paper appeared in Science, we all evolutionists were shocked, we are amazed, and we are elated, because suddenly we had a new field of science that we could use to study evolution. Indeed, there's a field of evolution that has been exploding, really advancing faster. And now we have, in fact, the whole tree of life, very simplified here, the large universal common ancestor going to bacteria, to archaea, which are bacteria-like organisms. You may not have, many of you may not have heard of them, but they are very abundant. And then eukaryotes, which are animal organisms like us with very complex cells. Notice that the length of these branches are approximately proportional to the diversity of species in that group. So two things to point out. One is here are all the animals. All the 1.5 million species of animals now known, we think that maybe as many as 10 million, are a small part of the world of life. I think this, at least to many people, including to me, when that first this kind of evidence started to come out, was amazing. That up to 300 years ago, people knew only about these three kinds of organisms, plants, fungi, and animals, and yet represent a part, a very small part, of the whole world of evolution. All the other organisms are microscopic, including most of the eukaryotes. So now, in the 1990s, after efforts of in some states and in some school boards to introduce what is called creationism in the schools, including a famous case in Arkansas in 1980, to which Michael Clegg referred earlier, after these ideas of creationism were declared unconstitutional, actually by the Supreme Court of the United States, to be taught in science classes because they are religious ideas, then a group of authors, not very many, probably less than a dozen, or surely less than a dozen, who have written extensively, who have published books, introduced this new idea of so-called intelligent design, arguing the same argument that had been advanced by William Paley, but by the way, not as well as William Paley. But of course, between William Paley and now, we have Darwin, and you know, and the explanation of how evolution happens by natural selection. Well, the claim of these authors is that natural selection cannot explain evolution, and the only bona fide biologist among these authors is Michael Behe. He's a professor at Lehigh University. He's not an evolutionist, a molecular biologist, but he wrote a book called Darwin's Black Box, where he says, as I said, what William Paley had said much better, that design is the purpose for arrangement of parts. And he introduces a new concept, which is irreducible complexity. He says, what is something, why is something is irreducibly complex? He says, when we have many parts, all of which have to be put together at the same time for the organ to function, he says, natural selection will not do it, because natural selection does a little bit at a time, one part at a time, but that's not how these organs and these functions come about. So here you have the eye again, or unless you have every part, the eye is not going to function. So he says it could not come by natural selection. Well, all the examples that he does, he uses, in addition to the eye, three others, all have been reconstructed by evolutionists step by step, gene by gene, how they have come about. In the case of the eye, which is the most readily understandable for people who are not expert molecular biologists, we can reconstruct the evolution of the eye. We don't have to go to fossils. We go to mollusks. Mollusks are a group of organisms which are much more diversified and much larger, many more species than vertebrates. We are vertebrates, so more technically chordates. So they are much more diversified. Moreover, mollusks, which include oysters, clams, snails, very notably octopuses and squids, they, many of them have lived in environments that have not changed over the years, over millions of years, so that there is no reason why they would have evolved, so they retain some primitive features, and here we are. This is a limpet. I don't know whether you are familiar with limpets. These are little mollusks, conic configuration. The larger diameter at the base is about the size of a fingernail. And they live in the intertidal on the rocks. I can see them, and I amuse students, little students, not university students who know better, by going there and say, stay still and look at the rock. And suddenly you start to see features that seem irregularities of the rock. They are moving around. They are these limpets feeding. So what do these animals need with respect to light? They need to know whether there is light or not. And for that, they need only a few light-sensitive cells and a few nerve fibers. So if there is light, this is low tide, this is time to feed, the algae and other microorganisms that have been brought by the tide. If there is no light, the tide is on, it's time to attach to the rock, and that's why they are able to attach themselves so strongly that if you try, and again, I play this game with school children, try to pick up one of them as they have seen the movie, try to grab them, there's no way you can move them. They attach themselves to the rock, no matter how much strength you want to apply, you cannot move them. Well, they have to resist the strength of the tide. You are going to survive. So there you have as simple an eye as you wanted. Here you have something called, in English, a slit shell mollusk. This is a creature that in Spain we eat it as a delicacy. It's, it's very abundant in northwestern Spain. And also in some of the coast of China, so the Chinese also eat this. This creature is called in Spanish navaja, pocket knife, because they are elongated and the animal comes out in the middle like that. Well, this not only see whether it's light or not, but they can see the direction of light. Here you have Nautilus. This is a snail which lives in the open ocean. And this is an example that Darwin uses, that organisms that have not changed for millions and millions of years, because there are fossils of Nautilus of 50 million years ago, they are the same as current Nautilus. You remember the point of Darwin in his theory of natural selection and evolution by natural selection is that organisms do not necessarily evolve, only evolve when in response to the changes in the environment. So here you have Nautilus, which can see the direction of light, but also can detect motion. Here you have another marine snail, and here you have a squid or an octopus. They have eyes as complex as ours. It's called a camera eye, and they see better than we do, as we know from various sorts of experiments, and they don't have a defect that we do. You recall the representations of the human eye that I had. We have the optical nerve going from the retina, from the inside the eye, because it's in the vertebrates, the nerve fibers started forming in the inside the optical cavity from the beginning of evolution, and now the optic nerve forms inside the cavity and has to cross the retina to reach the brain, to carry the information. So we have a blind spot, as you most of you know. The evolution of octopus and squids took place by the nerve fibers always forming outside the cavity, so the optic nerve does not have to cross the retina, so they don't have this defect that we do, which is, as I sometimes tell of the proponents of intelligent design, proof definitive that God loves squids and octopuses more than he loves us. Well, here you have a summary of those five. So to end, I just my purpose today was to convince you that the important contributions of Copernicus and Galileo and Newton was the beginning of the scientific revolution, which made us understand the planets and the stars and the formation of the galaxies. They have left organisms out, and that the scientific revolution is completed by Darwin with his theory of natural selection, which tells us why fish have gills and other animals have legs for running and birds have wings for flying. Thank you very much. Thank you.